In this video, we're computing the surface area of a sphere, starting from the assumption that we know the formula for the circumference of a circle. So in the picture, we see the main idea here. We're going to slice this sphere into thin ribbons, and the angular location of each of those ribbons is given with this angle theta with respect to the horizontal. So the particular ribbon that we're looking at in the picture actually has a negative theta, and the distance from the center of the sphere to the edge of this ribbon is big R, the radius of the sphere. And just to illustrate how these rings are going to build up the entire surface, we can see in the animation that as we start at the south pole of the sphere, that would be a theta of negative pi over 2, we have rings of a very small radius. And then as theta increases, the radius of the rings grows. The rings eventually reach a maximum radius at the equator of the sphere. And then they begin to shrink again as we get closer to the north pole of the sphere, where theta is equal to pi over 2. So the main strategy for this physical integration problem is that we need to get the dimensions of the ring labeled, and then we're going to cut and unroll this thing and express its area as a differential quantity, and then use an integral to add up all the rings. So the first thing I want to point out here is that the radius of this ring is not big R. We already saw in the animation that the radius of the rings changes as you change the angle theta. So we can visualize the radius of this particular ring, and we're going to call it little r. So the radius of our particular ring is given by big R times the cosine of this angle theta, because that's the adjacent side of a right triangle here. Now, probably the trickier part of figuring out the dimensions of this individual ribbon is to figure out the width of it. And because we're trying to phrase everything in terms of an integration variable of theta, we visualize the infinitesimal angle swept out by the width of that ribbon, and that's just called d theta. Now, this gives us the width or thickness of the ribbon by applying the old formula from geometry, S equals R theta. So the thickness of that ribbon traces out this infinitesimal arc on a circle that we call DS, and that's given by the radius there, which is the radius of the entire sphere, times the size of the angle, which is this infinitesimal D theta. So now that all the dimensions of this ribbon are labeled, we slice it and unroll it into a thin rectangle. And now we can label the dimensions of this rectangle. And we'll just start with the thickness ds. So that's just given by r times d theta. Now, how about the length of this thing? So we cut this ring and unrolled it, and the length is equal to the circumference of the original rolled up ribbon. So that's 2 pi times its radius. But we have to be really careful to use the little r here, because the radius of our rings is changing as a function of theta. And so after cutting and unrolling this ribbon, we end up with a length on this rectangle of 2 pi big R cosine of theta. So now that we know the dimensions of this rectangle that results from unrolling a single ribbon, we can write down the area contribution of this ribbon. And we're going to call that dA for an infinitesimal area contribution. Well, the area of a rectangle is just length times width. So we're going to multiply these two quantities, and that gives us a 2 pi R squared, where that's the big R, that's the constant radius of the sphere, times the cosine of theta, d theta. And because that's phrased entirely in terms of a single variable, we're prepared to integrate this thing. So the entire area is just the sum of all the area contributions. This is what an integral does. It just adds up a bunch of continuously changing infinitesimal quantities. So we have the integral of 2 pi r squared cosine theta d theta. And then we have to put in the limits of integration. Well, to get to the south pole of the sphere, we use an angle of negative pi over 2. And to get to the north pole of the sphere, an angle of pi over 2. And I'm going to go ahead and take advantage of the symmetry of the cosine function here. That's an even function, which means we can cut the integration interval in half and just double the result. As I do that, I'm going to move all the constants out in front of the integral. So I end up with a 4 pi r squared, because that symmetry trick produced a factor of 2. And then we have the integral from 0 to pi over 2 cosine theta d theta. And just to talk about that symmetry trick in a more practical way, all we're saying here is that we can take the surface area of the upper half of the sphere, that's 0 to pi over 2, and then double the result. So that's another way of looking at where the factor of 2 came from. So now we just have to guess the antiderivative and evaluate across the endpoints. And I end up with 4 pi r squared, and the antiderivative of cosine is just the sine function, so I have sine theta. And we're evaluating as theta goes from 0 to pi over 2. Note that when we sub in the lower limit there, sine of 0 is 0, so we don't have to worry about that. That's the whole advantage of using symmetry tricks. It's just that zeros are really convenient. And then in the upper limit, sine of pi over 2 is just 1. So I end up with a final answer for my surface area of a sphere of radius r. And it turns out to be the familiar formula, 4 pi r squared. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.